2024 was a year filled with Sony games on PC, and this year is kicking off strong with Insomniac's Marvel's Spider-Man 2, which was a technical showcase on PS5, serving as one of the best demonstrations of ray tracing on the console. And this PC port is handled by Nixies, a studio known for its excellent work on previous PC ports. However, this time the results are far from ideal. On the plus side, unlike the PS5 version, which relies entirely on ray tracing, this PC version includes fallback options like screen space and cube map reflections. This makes the game accessible to GPUs without ray tracing capabilities, a commendable decision, especially as mandatory ray tracing is slowly becoming the norm. Unfortunately, that's where the good news ends, as the game's performance and stability on PC leave a lot to be desired. At first glance, performance seems solid when standing still, but simply and the camera causes wild fluctuations. The situation worsens when traversing the city at high speed, where the game becomes heavily CPU limited, leading to severe frame time spikes, which is a major issue in a game where fast-paced traversal and swinging through the city are core gameplay mechanics. On the other hand, the graphics menu delivers exactly what you'd expect from Nixies, as the game offers a large number of graphic settings and options and includes all upscalers in their latest versions. So let's start by examining these upscalers and image quality. At 1440p using quality mode, none of these upscalers deliver a perfectly stable image. Even DLSS exhibits some shimmering and aliasing, though it looks more stable compared to the other options. iGTI in particular delivers the worst image quality in my opinion, and is best avoided. In terms of performance on the 3060 Ti, FSR surprisingly performs almost on par with DLSS, while XeSS falls slightly behind, and iGTI offers the best performance. At native resolution with the same sharpness level, DLAA appears softer compared to FSR AA and XeAA. However, as expected, it delivers the most stable image. And when it comes to performance, unlike when upscaling, FSR is slower than DLAA and performs on par with XeSS AA, while the in-game TAA offers the best performance. Finally, here is a quick look at how turning off anti-aliasing altogether or using SMAA looks and performs compared to TAA. Although the game includes one of the latest DLSS DLL versions, it still utilizes the older preset E, and I tested preset G by overriding it with the Nvidia app and comparing it to the default preset E, and the difference was clear. Preset G looks significantly better, it's sharper and more stable, especially when looking at hair or other fine details. However, there are some visual issues with preset G, particularly with certain trees, which can exhibit noise and shimmering, as you can see here. Additionally, preset G comes at a cost. On the 3060 Ti, I measured around 11% performance hit in this scene. Thankfully, there is a new preset called preset K, which can be enabled using Nvidia Profile Inspector. This preset looks almost as good as preset G while also reducing the tree artifacts issue, making it a great alternative. And if you want to try this new preset, I'll leave all the instructions in the description and pinned comment down below. Let's move on to the quality settings, starting with texture quality. Here, only medium and above deliver good-looking textures for most surfaces, but some areas still exhibit a low-res appearance with medium, and high and very high look almost identical. In terms of VRAM, similar to many other Nixies ports, this game is quite demanding. Here on the 8GB 3060 Ti, even with medium at 1440p with quality DLSS, I noticed that sometimes some textures fail to load properly, and I had to switch to low and reapply medium to fix the issue. But despite this, I still recommend medium for 8GB GPUs. Anything higher may lead to performance issues. Moving on to texture filtering. As usual, this setting has a massive visual impact, as you can see here, but its performance impact is negligible, so leave it at 16x. Next we have shadow quality. This controls both the resolution and level of softness of the shadows, and in my opinion higher options don't always produce the best results. This setting also affects character self shadows, where we can see a noticeable improvement starting from medium. Performance wise, this setting is surprisingly not very demanding. Going from very low to ultra only results in around a 4% performance hit in this area, but despite this I recommend medium or high. Let's move on to ambient occlusion. Despite the fact that HPAO Plus and XE GTAO are more advanced than SSAO, SSAO here in my opinion looks better as the game was designed with SSAO in mind, and it complements the art style and lighting more effectively than HPAO Plus and XE GTAO. Performance wise, SSAO costs around 4%, HPAO Plus around 12%, and XE GTAO around 14%. So for this one I recommend SSAO. Moving on to screen space reflections. SSR adds a lot to the game's visuals, and there is no noticeable visual difference between low and high. And SSR here comes with a small performance cost of around 3%, so I recommend leaving it at high. Let's move on to ray tracing, starting with ray traced reflections. And for this effect, we have multiple settings, with the first one controlling the resolution of RT reflections. Very high offers significantly higher resolution compared to high. However, this comes with a massive performance cost of around 30% on the 4070 Super. The second setting is ray traced geometry detail, which can only be adjusted when RT reflections are enabled, and it controls the level of detail of the geometry that is being ray traced against, and very high here costs around 20%. And the third and last setting is ray traced object range. This slider determines how many objects are included in the RT reflections, as you can see here. And performance wise, when CPU bound, the impact becomes significant only when going from 5 to 10, with 10 costing around 18%. So if you want to enable RT reflections, I recommend sticking to high for the reflection resolution with high geometry detail, while keeping the object range at 5 or the default 6, which in the worst case scenario, such as in the rain with multiple reflective surfaces, costs around 26% compared to screen space and cube map reflections. Moving on to ray trace interiors. This effect enhances the look of interiors visible through windows by ray tracing reflections against rear rooms hidden in the map. However, this ray tracing effect is quite expensive. Here on the 4070 Super, I measured around 34% performance loss when using high and 41% when using very high. Therefore, I recommend keeping this one off. It does not add much to the overall visuals, and it's barely noticeable during normal gameplay. Next we have ray traced shadows. Just like in Miles Morales, RT shadows in this game tend to hurt the visuals more than they improve them. Most RT shadows look static and don't animate, such as the shadow of this tree. Performance wise, going from off to medium costs around 32%, to high 35%, and to very high 40%. So given the limited visual benefit and the significant performance hit, I recommend keeping ray traced shadows disabled. And the last ray tracing effect is ray trace ambient occlusion. RTAO has a subtle visual impact, as you can see here, when compared to SSAO. And while RTAO might offer more accurate shading in some areas, SSAO fits the game's art style better in my opinion. And despite this subtle visual impact, RTAO is incredibly expensive. Here, going from SSAO to high RTAO costs around 36%, and to very high about 40%. So I highly recommend keeping this one disabled. So generally speaking, the only ray tracing effect worth enabling is ray traced reflections. Therefore, if you have enough performance to spare along with sufficient VRAM, CPU and GPU power, consider enabling RT reflections. Now let's move on to DLSS ray reconstruction. This feature isn't working as intended in this game. For example, if we take a look at RT reflections, enabling ray reconstruction, whether using the legacy or the new transformer model, leads to significant shimmering in the RT reflections. And the same issue occurs with RT shadows, where DLSS ray reconstruction introduces noticeable boiling artifacts. These are especially pronounced in the legacy mode, while the transformer mode suffers through a lesser extent. And although DLSS ray reconstruction does improve the quality of RTAO, similar to RT shadows and refluxions, it introduces more noise and visual issues, as you can see here. And in terms of performance, ray reconstruction comes with a significant cost. Using the legacy mode results in around a 23% performance hit, while the transformer mode costs about 29%. Also, keep in mind that with a 20 or 30 series GPU, transformer ray reconstruction will be even more expensive. So for now, I highly recommend keeping DLSS ray reconstruction disabled if you are using ray tracing. Moving on to level of detail, and here the biggest change occurs when going from very low to low. While higher options gradually improve geometry quality and draw distance for distant objects, in terms of performance, going from very low to low costs around 8%, medium 16%, high 23%, very high 28%, and finally to ultra 36%. So for this one, I recommend medium or high, and if you have extra performance to spare, consider very high to further reduce LOD popping. Next, we have traffic density. This setting doesn't affect the density of traffic up close, but rather impacts the amount of traffic at a distance, as you can see here. In terms of performance, it shows no significant impact even when CPU limited and traversing the city at high speed. Therefore, I recommend leaving this one at high or very high. Let's move on to crowd density. This one adjusts the number of NPCs, and performance-wise, the impact becomes significant when going to very high and ultra, so I recommend leaving this one at high. Next, we have hair quality. This one controls the density and quality of main character's hair, as you can see here, and it can be quite demanding at higher levels. Here, going from very low to medium costs around 5%, to high 13%, and to very high 19%, so for this one, I recommend medium. Moving on to weather particle quality. From what I have noticed, this setting affects two key aspects. First, it controls the density of raindrops, though this has no significant impact on performance. It also enables volumetric clouds when set to medium or higher, as you can see here. And this is where this setting becomes more demanding. Here, going from low to medium costs around 4%, to high 9%, and to very high 15%. So for this one, I recommend medium. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Marvel's Spider-Man 2. Let's now compare the performance of optimized settings versus the very high preset at native 1440p using DLAA with no ray tracing on either side. And here we can see around 22% performance improvement with optimized settings. While this isn't a massive boost, I wouldn't recommend lowering the settings any further. Instead, consider using dynamic resolution or upscaling. And if you want the most consistent performance without those frame time spikes, I recommend combining optimized settings with dynamic resolution while capping the frame rates using River Tuner or any other tool. And as you can see here, this combination delivers a more consistent frame times. And I know I've been recommended capping the frame rates a lot lately, but the state of PC gaming in early 2025 has been far from ideal, and it's quite disappointing to see a studio like Nixies releasing an unfinished PC port, but I hope they address these issues soon. And with that, we arrive at the end. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.